Welcome to another explore. This time I'm back in the city of Chester and I'm crossing the Shropshire Union Canal. That way heads north to Ellesmere Port and the Manchester Ship Canal. That way leads to the city of Chester and ultimately Shrewsbury and the River Severn. But I'm not here to look at this part of the canal.
This extremely short stretch of canal is known as the Dee branch. As you can see, it's pretty weeded up at the end there by the bridge. In 20 years I've never seen a boat go beyond the lock or the bridge, and this part of it here is really only used for mooring. In fact, I don't think these boats move a great deal. Let's go and have a look anyway.
Before we head off towards River Dee along the canal, I thought we'd just take a quick look at the map just to show you exactly where we are. Now, the bridge that I'm standing on over the Dee branch is indicated by the arrow. And I am going to be walking south along the towpath, also indicated by the arrow. Now, I said earlier that this Dee branch was a very short stretch of canal. It is in fact just a tad over a quarter of a mile long, and not very long distance at all.
Look at these brilliant old posts. Obviously were lamp posts at one time. Neglected now, but would be brilliant if they were brought back into use. They certainly benefit the area. There's another one. Right, let's go down these stairs. There you can see, in fact there's a sign that wasn't there a few weeks ago that says canal closed. Not that you'd probably be able to get into it due to all the weeds.
Despite that short distance, it was an incredibly important canal as it was the only link to the River Dee and Chester Port, which was vital as Chester was now competing not only with Liverpool for unloading trade, but also the age-old problem of the river silting up, which would ultimately be its undoing. The Dee branch was constructed at the same time as the Ellesmere section and opened in 1797, reaching Netherpool, later renamed Ellesmere Port, in the north and joining the Chester Canal a little south of here. Amalgamated in 1813 and again in 1845 under the guise of the Shropshire Union Railways and Canal Company. Today, it's recognised as the Shropshire Union Canal, which stretches from the Manchester Ship Canal and Ellesmere Port to Shrewsbury.
Now these lock gates are not in the best of condition. In fact, there doesn't appear to be much of a gate there at all. Oh, well, that, the canal is extreme. In fact, yeah, it's the canal that's extremely high. Look, it's over the top of the lock gate.
The bridge ahead of us carries South View Road over the canal, and I believe gives the name to the lock of Bridge Lock. As I said earlier, I've never seen anything afloat past this lock into the basin beyond. But if anyone has, I'd be interested to know.
So this is the Dee Basin. Boats would come from up there, which is the Shropshire Union Canal or Chester Canal, and they'd come all the way down here through this lock and into here, into the Dee Basin, which back in the day was much, much larger. These houses here have been built recently and it would have stretched all the way over there. I'll walk around the best I can in a minute. The original perimeter. Over there we've got the water tower, but that's for another part of this story. So let's walk around the perimeter, see what we can see. So we're walking up these steps onto South View Road. The wall looks pretty old. Classic Cheshire sandstone. Now these buildings are built right on top of the basin. The basin would have been the edge of it, probably about 60-70 feet in from the wall.
And if you were to look on the maps dated 1899 on the National Library of Scotland, were you to look over this wall here towards the canal, you would have just seen wharves and landing areas. No warehouses or other buildings. Probably a mix of barges and larger shipping, cargo being unloaded, maybe the clank of rope on mast as the wind blows through the rigging, and experience the smells and sounds of an active dockyard.
So there's an area here. So we're now walking in towards the base, and I would probably say where this little bump in the road is, where it changes surface, that's about the edge of the basin, roughly speaking. So it's probably double in size.
And you can see the edge of the modern day basin, which is pretty much where those cars are parked.
Let's go back out onto South View Road. Now, making our way out of Ellesport, we come back onto South View Road again, and you'll notice that although we still have modern buildings to our left, to our right, we have some lovely older buildings which would have been synonymous with the buildings which were effectively wharves, warehouses, etc. on our left, now replaced by this modern construction. So we're now moving out onto Sealham Road in front of us, and in the trees beyond is the River Dee. A And those buildings where we're just getting our first glimpse of coming into view on Seagham Road, they edge the quayside, and they would have been the port of Chester. Obviously they're new. So we've pretty much walked around the whole of the basin now. Walking along Seagham Road for a short distance. And this bridge in front of us crosses the short stretch of canal. To our right, as I said, there's the River Dee. You can just see that. And to our left is what remains of the Dee Basin.
We're going to turn to our map once more to clarify a couple of points. Walking around the basin's old perimeter could show only so much. So using the overlay, you can see just how big the basin used to be and how much modernity has impeded upon it. Now, I knew a lot of the basin was infilled in the 1950s. Interestingly, a number of abandoned barges were left in situ and used as part of that infill. This photo, dated 1935, shows those barges laid up and rotting since 1921, when the Shropshire Union Railways and Canal Company ceased operating them. Looking at the photo, I've tried to locate on the map just where the position of these barges would have been. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, but the arrow shows where I believe them to be. My thinking, using the buildings behind, and they seem to match those in the position marked upon the map. And that same area in today's basin, the barges are buried beneath these apartments. Returning to the map, if you look towards the western end of the basin, you will see a swing bridge marked. This is Seagham Road today, the exact point where that swing bridge was located. And the actual swing bridge, looking in the same direction of travel.
So here we are coming in back into the basin area from the Dee side, the side where the River Dee is. Now all this would have been canal basin. The ships or boats would have moored up here. So although still called the basin, there's probably about a third the size that it used to be. The wall on that side is pretty much the original perimeter, been redeveloped in places. So,
staying with this shot for a moment, we'll return to the water tower, visible just to the right of the lifting bridge. A few steps away from the basin, and the water tower can be easily accessed. There's another of those sandstone walls so common in Chester.
I think this has all been re-landscaped and the Victorian period. But it's still absolutely wonderful. And I think the basin used to edge, in fact I'm pretty certain it edged up to the tower. There's a very well documented or etching from the 1700s which shows water right up to the edge of this tower here.
Grade 1 listed structure, it was constructed in the first half of the 1320s. At that time the River Dee lapped against its base. Built for defence of the city and monitoring movements upon the river, it became high and dry by the latter years of the 16th century. During the Civil War, it was re-employed in a defensive role before becoming abandoned by the mid-1750s. In the late 1790s, water lapped against its side again when the canal basin was constructed. Since 1835 and up to today, it has been used in various guises as a museum. Clear of Sealham Road, and there is only this short stretch of the Dee branch before the open river. However, this is the first or last area of original stonework since I passed Bridge Lock. Now, stepping towards the river, I'm now stepping onto the area of the Port of Chester, so either side of the canal here. Either side of the lock would have been wharves with ships tied up. You can see the recess there, the metal recess where the lock gates, the very last lock gates, used to be situated. There's a good shot of the recess. And there's still what appear to be metal brackets maybe. Now that good shot gives a good indication of the drop between the canal level and the actual river. Here's a video I filmed just a few weeks earlier, and it shows excellently how high the river can flood, allowing boats entry into the canal and beyond. Returning to low water, and this gives a good example of the problematic silt which dogged the Port of Chester throughout its existence. That huge bank with vegetation whereas once would have seen vessels of all sizes docked against the quayside. Before I go off and explore the remains of the former port, I was drawn to this simple drawing from 1867. In particular, the sluice house and the cheese stage. Research indicated that the cheese stage was literally that, moorings and jetties where cheese was unloaded and stored in warehouses. The sluice house, however, may still exist. Let's look at the National Library of Scotland map dated 1899, and the sluice house is clearly marked there on Sealham Road. Today's view isn't as revealing, however, There is a building on that exact spot, so let's go and investigate. This raised embankment I'm walking along is in a small park known as the Cop, just off Sealham Road. The word cop derives from the Anglo-Saxon cop, spelt K-O-P-P, and means a hedge bank. This particular cop is believed to date from the early 18th century and is the only surviving example of flood defences in this area. As interesting as this is, I'm actually looking for something else. I'll just take this short path out onto Sealham Road, and there we have it. This building is believed to either be the sluice house, or at least have part of the sluice house incorporated into it. It's a good bet, as it's bang on according to the map, and despite being magnificently restored, it retains a definite look of age, particularly that of the turn of the 18th and 19th centuries. Given a bit of credence to the sluice house's position and authenticity is this bridge and the stream it crosses. Just a few yards away, it's perfectly located, as are a few other similar streams, which could be used to draw water away from the river at times of imminent flood. This particular one drains into Finchett's Gutter, a small stream which empties itself of floodwater into the site of Blaken Marshes. This area can still be seen underwater at various times throughout the year. As for the bridge, it's clearly of an old construction from a couple of centuries past. Only one wall remains, which alas loses its aged charm as it's faced off by a modern pedestrian bridge. Yeah, look at that. It looks like there was once a plaque, probably denoting a construction date or similar. Here in this view you can see the stream that the sluice house probably operated. It actually takes a dog leg towards the river, towards the left. And here you can see the proximity of the sluice house. As usual when I come to a tunnel, I feel a compulsion to look into it. This one was no exception. Now, despite that great big modern pipe, it's clear, it seems to be clear, that the original build appears to stretch the entire road width, disclosing that it's just the opposite wall which is missing and causing the bridge to be incomplete, which is quite a shame really. Leaving the sluice house behind, I'm moving east once more so I can explore the quayside of the old port.
River Dee is in full flood today. Look at those daffodils growing out of salt water. It's incredible.
I'm continuing to walk east, away from the Dee lock. To my left, where you can now see modern apartments, you would have heard the hammering from a blacksmith's. To my right, a slipway sloping into the waters of the Dee. This part of the old port is known as New Crane Wharf, after a crane which I'll talk about shortly. The large white building shown here, despite suffering from many modern applications, manages to retain much of its former appearance, that of a warehouse. This black and white print from the mid-1800s shows that same warehouse building, however I believe it was built somewhat earlier, sometime in the mid-1700s. Today, it's used for commercial and residential purposes. I'm walking back towards the river now, and New Crane Wharf along New Crane Bank. In my opinion, these buildings are the best examples of 18th century dockside houses and warehouses on this entire site. As you can see, if you were to remove the cars and modern signage, you could almost be back in the 1700s. This former warehouse, now used as the home of the Chester Sea Cadets, was built in 1736, and as with the rest of the terrace, remains locked in the past. It really is a fantastic building, isn't it? You've got those large hatches which would have seen all sorts of cargo hoisted up into the warehouse. And this building is nearly 300 years old. When you see it next to the waterside there, it's very evocative of a time now consigned to history. Now this area here used to have a loading crane on the corner, and if you look at the old paintings and etches, you can clearly see this is exactly where it was. Looking again at the map, Crane Wharf appears to have had two cranes. You can see them both marked with a C. While in both these images depicting the port of Chester in the mid-19th century, both cranes on Crane Wharf can clearly be seen.